Greetings, welcome, and God bless you.
Hey, man, welcome back.
It's good to be here tonight. Welcome to RLM TV, live from Miami, Florida. Let's get right into the teaching. It's going to be rich tonight, so buckle up, buttercup. We're in the fast lane. These are the tribes of Israel. Come on. You know, each tribe had its own flag. We see there the tribe of Manasseh, Benjamin, Asher, Naphtali, Gad, Dan, Zebulun, Issachar, Judah, Simeon, Reuben, Ephraim. These patriarchs are our patriarchs because we are engrafted into Israel. Romans 11, it is written. It is very important that Christianity today return to its Jewish roots in the fulfillment of the works of the apostles and the Lamb. And that is what the new covenant actually is. So we really need this desperately during these days because we have strayed so far that we're not even connected to the original first century Christianity of Jesus Christ and his apostles. But we will be connected as we study Torah faithfully, the scriptures, Psalms, Proverbs, wisdom faithfully, and the prophets and the gospels and Acts and the epistles and Revelation. And we will be connected, no longer disconnected, but fully connected to all that is available to us today. Reuben is the first, Simeon the aggressor, Levi the cleric, the priest. Now you may look at these 12 flags right now, the tribes of Israel, and we see it. This is the official United Tribes of Israel of RLM TV. That's why we have the stars up in the corner according to how many stars we've merited in this ministry right now and our souls of our crown. Amen. So you might ask, well, where's Levi? Well, tune in tomorrow. We will talk tomorrow about the tribe of Levi exclusively, but that is for another time. Tonight we're in the 12 tribes, and we're going to be talking about the evil eye and the good eye and a whole lot more. Levi is the cleric, the priest, the full-time minister, Judah the leader, Dan the judge, Naphtali the free spirit, Gad the warrior, Asher the prosperous one, Issachar the scholar, Zebulun the business person, Joseph the sufferer, Manasseh reconnection, Ephraim transformation, Benjamin the ravenous consumer. And these definitions and their attributes all come from the names that the mothers gave them, the blessing of Jacob at the end of his life and the blessing of Moses at the end of his life. And so we understand what the 12 tribes, our patriarchs of Christianity, are functioning in our lives through wisdom, but it is more than just that. It is our existence. It's our protocol of existence. These flags are angelic banners, and we are born again angelic beings in Christ. 2 Corinthians 5:17, if anyone's in Christ, they're a new creature, living creature, angelic creature. Psalms 82 says, in the Hebrew Tanakh, have I not said you are angels? Angel-like beings. And actually says in Hebrew, angels. And it doesn't add anything. It doesn't say gods. It just says angels. And so that's important because Jacob's letter, Genesis 28, John 1:51, is for angels. It's for the angelic part of you. So we put less emphasis on the small red worm of the flesh, the nephesh soul that's in the blood. That's the small red worm. That term comes from the Hebrew of what the nephesh soul is. The nephesh soul, if you're taking notes, you might want to write this in the comments just so you understand it. The nephesh soul that's in the blood is the small red worm soul. That is totally accurate and biblical. Now we're going to develop your other souls. If you're born again and speak in tongues, you have a ruah soul. That is your invitation to Jacob's ladder. But it comes with protocol and repentance. You're going to have to come out of the other nations. You can still fly U.S. flag, Israeli flag, Russian flag, you know, United Kingdom flag, Canadian flag, any Mexican flag. We love all the nations. But this is your eternal nation of Israel as believers. So this trumps all of that. This triumphs over all of that. This is eternity. And this is the wisdom of the ages, and we need it now more than ever. Therefore, let these flags be flown over you, your souls, your red worm soul, the nephesh, and your ruah soul as well. Amen. And you need to. His banner over you is love. Well, love is unfolded in the 12 tribes of Israel because it came through the matriarchs of our faith. So we begin to understand it much more deeply than just surface level, and that is called wisdom and understanding, counsel, might, knowledge, fear of the Lord, and the Spirit of the Lord that is upon you for understanding today. Today's teaching, the good eye consuming the evil eye, Abraham's sons devouring Balaam's sons. Balaam is the Hebrew form of Balaam. We could say Abraham as well if we wanted to say the Hebrew version. Either one works. Both are totally kosher as long as you understand. The key to unlocking never-ending revival in the elements of Malkut of Messiah is bum bum bum. The good eye can only be obtained through the school of the patriarchs, not God directly, because Gentiles are engrafted into Israel's tree. That's what Galatians says, that's what Revelation says, that's what Romans 11 says. You're engrafted into Israel. You're not engrafted into God directly. That is totally heresy, and that's important, because we'll get into this. God doesn't have a direct tree. Yadav Vave's tree is the Jewish patriarchs. That's why he calls Jacob his son, Isaac his son, Abraham his son, David his son. If you skip the sons, you skip God, because God builds with living stones. All right? Amen. So that's in Romans 11, Galatians, etc. It's throughout all the scriptures. If you're a good Berean, you already know that. Therefore, direct connection of skipping the previous saints, especially the patriarchs of Judaism, especially the apostles, Rebekah and I, and other apostles, is unbiblical and great heresy. This is not small heresy. This is Balaam evil eye activity, that you are in the student camp of the evil eye. If you are skipping the patriarchs, if you are robbing the apostles and prophets, not giving them credit for anything they're doing, robbing their mitzvahs, robbing their works, and saying, oh, it all belongs to God, it's not Brandon's, I can take it and use it in my own ministry and plagiarize, and it, because he got it from God, therefore I can steal it from him. You are in the school of Balaam. You are a servant of the evil eye, and God's not going to tolerate anymore. That is the citizenship of hell, the citizenship of Edom, and the unholy nation of Esau, the red star. It's Satan's camp. Luke 1:51, even as he promised to our forefathers, Abraham and his descendants forever. That's from Mary's song. Notice the gospel is for what? Promises of forefathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Gospels of Jesus Christ, the New Testament, the New Covenant. The direct God relation without the patriarchs is the core evil eye deception of the nation of Edom, Esau, Samael, and the red magic of the Kelopot. Yadav Vave uses men and women only to complete his will. Matriarchs, patriarchs, apostles, and prophets. And Jesus said, well, you only honor them after they're dead. Why? Because you can rob from them and not give them any credit during their life. You're the murderers of the prophets. He was exposing that their citizenship was not really in Israel, not in Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, not in the Cave of Treasures, that they were wicked, serving the fallen angels in a different spiritual nation. And then he said, your father is the devil. And they pick up stones to murder him, it is written, but he walked through their midst because he walked on sapphire stones. Natural stones can't touch sapphire stones. He has all the archangels with him, and he just ignored them. He's flying higher than the camp of daggers and knives. Amen. So we see Yadav Vave only uses men and women to complete his will and plans, mitzvahs on the earth and through the heavens. The Kelopot attempts to remove man's mitzvahs, steal the rewards, and say it's God's directly, stealing the merit that was merited by the son of Abraham performing the mitzvah. Do you see that? They're always trying to steal the works of those who are in obedience to the angelic protocol, who have the good eye in their heart. The evil eye is the thief that comes to steal, kill, and destroy. So let this all be exposed in everyone's lives, and get it out of your lives, your hearts, your minds, your souls, your houses, your relationships, your marriages, and have a good eye only of the school of Abraham, who had only a good eye. Amen? Amen. This is how we conquer. This is how we overcome. This is the protocol for all Christianity of all time. If we are sons and daughters of Abraham, we only practice the good eye. We never participate with the evil eye, with the hunting of Esau, of Nimrod, of pretending to be pious while murdering behind the back. That's what Nimrod means in Hebrew. Amen. So we are repenting of the evil eye tonight and only going to practice the good eye, which is goodwill towards all men. When the angels appeared to the shepherds at the birth of Messiah Jesus Christ in the Gospels, they said, peace and goodwill to all men. Why? What's the reason for that? Why is it recorded in our Gospels? It was to show them they were not from the evil eye. In Judaism, which is really true Christianity fulfilled with Messiah, you have to identify yourself, your citizenship, with the good eye or the evil eye. There's only two camps really on earth. The 70 nations of the evil eye, dashing those nations to pieces like pottery, is dashing the evil eye to pieces like pottery. All jealousy, all ill will towards others, all pretending to be pious while robbing and stealing and witchcraft, prayers and word curses. All of that wickedness is evil eye. That's all the nations of the earth. That's all demons. That's hell. That is hell. This is heaven. Heaven only practices good eye. The holy angels are only in the good eye of the good father continuously. Any participation with the evil eye, the angels will actually back off and be like, they'll honor your free will and say, if you want to go be a demon, go be a demon. We're sorry for you. We'll help you if you cry out to Jesus later on. Maybe you might die and go to hell in that camp. But the angels don't even go there. And really, the Holy Spirit won't even go there. You leave the Holy Spirit, the white dove just leave you. If you go into that camp and practice red magic and you begin to practice the Kalapat and the evil eye, God's not there. You're in hell. You put yourself in hell. Repent and come into heaven. Practice the good eye. There you'll find the angels. There you find the patriarchs. Princes of Rome and Greece operate as false God and false Jesus and false Holy Spirits directly. That's why all the Edomites of the red camp, they say, well, this is directly from Jesus. This is directly from God. This is directly from the Holy Spirit. But then they get enraged when you don't listen to them because they don't go through the patriarchs. They don't go through the protocol of the kingdom. They don't go through Jacob's ladder. They don't go through the cave of treasures. There's this like, oh, me, me, me. It's all self-absorbed. It's all evil eye. They attempt to remove all Judaism from Christianity. Let's expose the red camp and obliterate it from the earth today. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Thus, the nation of Edom, Esau, the red star, the evil eye, has grown to become the biggest heathen nation of false believers today in history.
Amen.
End of lesson.
Yeah, that about sums it up. That's
glory.
The problem. And here is the solution. It's time for you to get to the Cave of Treasures and go cosmic. If you are not yet cosmic, we repeat this often, but maybe we have someone new watching or maybe you've missed it so far. If you're not yet cosmic, which means you're not yet standing on the moon, clothed in the sun with the full circumcisions, now is the time to get the School of the Magi, download the app, go through the class as many times as you need. We have some people that are cosmic now. They went through the class multiple times because some of them came from a really strong Edomite background and upbringing. It's very common these days. So to get it out, they had to go through the class a few times, which means, and this is separate from the masterclass. The masterclass is really for ascension. But if you're not started on your journey of ascension, you're going to want to download the Glory Life app. It's available for the iPhone and for Android, and go through School of the Magi, and that appears for you as you create a profile. That should appear for you. You click on the hamburger button, and then there it is. Also on the home page, there's a button with the banner that says Masterclass. That takes you to the Masterclass. That's separate from the School of the Magi, which you can see in the little side navigation menu. You click on those three lines, that hamburger button, scroll down School of the Magi, and just go through each of the lessons, read them. You can read them or you can read them out loud, study them, and then begin to live them. Choose to live that way, right? You learn from it, you choose to live that way, and that's how you can get your full Malkut circumcision. And then, you know, I also encourage you, go through the masterclass. You can go through the masterclass at the same time you're taking School of the Magi, because there's some entry-level stuff in there, those first several videos that might actually help you as well. So it doesn't mean you have to finish Magi before you take the masterclass. But I wouldn't, there's not really any need to go farther than the freshman year unless you're already ascending with your valid circumcisions. It's a two-part circumcision as you're going and doing that. And so I just want to encourage you, there's a lot of people who are still on Malkut. Some people aren't even really coming out of the Red Camp yet.
Yeah.
If you are still not sure about the Red Camp, where you're at, these last few lessons that we've done this last week or two on this topic, save those videos for later. Go through and get it again. Just, you know, use wisdom and know where you are. Talk to the Lord, and He will lead you in the way everlasting. So this is a great chance for you to get to really know the Holy Ghost, to get to really know His voice and to walk in it. So we want you to be cosmic, but again, the worst thing you can do, what's worse than not going cosmic, is going cosmic and getting into some funny business on the other side, which we might get into here in just a minute.
Yeah, the Father is requiring some maturity, and all the joking, jesting, and mocking stuff is actually demonic activity in your nefesh, red worm souls, that is holding you back from your ascension. Some of you think it's joy, it's false joy. Some of you think it's freedom, it's false freedom. You're completely deceived, you're completely augured, and the Lord is just saying, please have sobriety. You know what I mean? He's like, you need to be sober-minded and vigilant, not a Pharisee, not religious, listen now, but the sobriety to understand accurately where your red worm is, which is your nefesh soul on earth, that ant. Let me teach you on the ants, right? You got a red ant here. It's a fire ant. Oh, hallelujah. It's got the fire of God, the baptism of fire. It's still an ant. The souls go up forever, okay? And they get bigger and bigger the higher you go, and more in divine intelligence, inner intelligence, the countenance of the face, the light of the face is the divine intelligence, Ecclesiastes 8, it is written. But we cannot have our emphasis on the little red worm. I mean, how much of us in our lives are just serving the worm? Now, the worm is a Hebrew term for the nefesh soul. That is not me being derogatory. That is what Torah teaches. That is what the scriptures and the prophets and even Jesus in the New Testament, it is the term for what the flesh is. It is a worm. You do have a worm farm, and you do feed the worm, and you take care of the worm, and the worm's got nice stuff. You know, we love the worm. If you don't love the worm, you're evil, okay? You take care of the worm. But we also need to develop all of the butterflies, the Ruah soul part of you, especially if you're Pentecostal charismatic believers, up into the higher realms. This is going to require you to get your consciousness, your mind, your thinking, your subconsciousness into the Torah, in the Word of God, and begin dealing with serious issues in your heart. The Father does not want you people being goofy. A lot of the young men are especially goofy. And the Lord rebuke you, Satan. Yes, I'm talking to you right now. I know, because He discipled all the goofiness out of me. You're goofy. You're from Goofenberg. And that goofiness is really just the immaturity masquerading as joy and freedom. But it's Satan. That's a demon spirit. So we have the cross of His blood to remove Goofenberg from us to get into Jerusalem. Amen. The cave of treasures. And a lot of you really just need to nail all of that immaturity of the youthfulness of the flesh. And a lot of times we're just hiding from God behind false joy, false freedom, all kinds of different idols that we hide behind. I mean, it could be your grass, could be your job, it could be something, you know, whatever it is. They're all idols. An idol is anything you build to hide from the good eye of the Father, the good Father. And so when Jesus came around beaming His Shekinah with His perfect connection to the Father, what materialized? The idols of every city He walked into, even on the countryside, even on the mountain and the valley, everywhere He went, on the lakes and the rivers and the seas. So He walked in such great light that it revealed everything that was hidden in the invisible dimension, which was evil eye or good eye. The Gadarene demoniac, best example in the Bible, is like, have you come to torment us before the appointed time? He's a mile away, and they begin shaking.
That's so good.
He revealed the whole Balaam system of the dead tree of the Kelopot of the fallen angels from a distance. Now, this is what we want in your hearts. You're going to have to sacrifice all those things that you pretend behind.
Yeah.
And listen, Rebekah and I can see it in all of you already, and we don't judge you or condemn you for it. We understand the process of melting down idols, not to harm you. We operate in the good eye. Otherwise, you know, we're false apostles. A true apostle is good eye only. A false apostle is evil eye, which means they have different kind of intentions that not to bring into the Father's throne. Most of this earth is filled with the false fivefold right now.
Right.
Let's be real. Now, the true fivefold will come forth with the good eye and the rise of Jesus Christ in hearts through circumcision as we're engrafted back into Israel, honoring our patriarchs, getting into real first century Christianity, which Edomite Christianity of Greece and Rome, which are two principality demons, they don't know anything about right now. And so we forgive the total ignorance of the believers because they have 1,700 years of scholarly lies under the principality of Rome and the principality of Greece to disconnect Christianity from Judaism on purpose so we would never understand what real Christianity is. Well, those days are over. We understand what it is. Mm-hmm. We're reconnecting. That's what Ephraim and Manasseh are. They're the reconnection to the Kabbalah, the oral tradition of the Messiah and the Apostles of the Lamb, which is the heavenly Jerusalem of Revelation written at the end of the first century. It was the pinnacle of the oral tradition of the Apostles of the Lamb. John, who was chief amongst his brethren, chief apostle Lamb, you know, John the Apostle of blessed memory. He is working now in the cloud of witnesses to reconnect Christianity to our Jewish roots. Amen. I mean, he really works hard in 1 John, 2 John, 3 John, and Revelation and the Gospel of John to reconnect people to what the promises are. It's not religious. It's not rebellious. It's simply New Covenant Kabbalah. The Kabbalah of John is great. A lot of people don't read it like that because they have a Roman demon or a Greek demon or a Latin demon or a religious demon or a poverty demon or some kind of unclean thing in them that they can't understand the scriptures because they're blinded, blind leading the blind in the Bible. And blind leading the blind in the Bible is usually going to church. We don't want blind churches. Mm-hmm. We want the good eye of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, God the Father, Lord Jesus Christ, the archangels, the real fivefold in operation out of the good eye, the release of Shekinah vision, the release of the seer anointing, emanating through all born-again believers in the world. We don't have that right now because of the disconnect from first century Jewish Christianity, because the reason why it's so important, because it's Kabbalah Christianity. Without the latter of John 1:51, your Christianity is Greek and Roman. It's limited to only Netzah and Hod of Isaiah, which is where, you know, Rick Joyner's at. That's where Bobby Connor's at. That's where David Hogan's at. That's where all. That's where Heidi Baker's at. That's where all the glory stream patriarchs and matriarchs who should be honored, who are faithful at their post, are at. You can't go any higher than Netzah or Hod of Isaiah unless you get into true Jewish Christianity of the first century. It doesn't mean you need to get circumcised in your penises. Mm-hmm. It means that you need to get circumcised in your hearts from glory to glory in the rungs of Jesus Christ's ladder of John 1:51, which is unknown right now in global Christianity. But it will become normal Christianity as it's taught at a scholarly level. The flag of Issachar, which is the scholar of sapphire stones, it scribes the scholarship of all things Yadivave is doing with the holy angels and the power of the Holy Spirit, so it becomes the norm. There was no Reformation in Germany until it was scribed by scholars. Hello? There was no Reformation of the Baptists. There's no Reformation of even the Pentecostals. The Pentecostals all now have universities. I went to one, North Central University Bible College, Minneapolis, Minnesota, for 5 years. And so once it becomes scholarly, then it becomes accepted. Doesn't mean it's always right, but once it hits the scholar realm, the scholar realm of, who's the scholar? Issachar. Once it hits the Issachar flag, the scholar, when the Issachar's flag is the sun and the moon, and it's written on sapphire stones, that doesn't mean you don't deal with Laban, the scholar demon, But that means you begin to establish your movement, even if it's Evil Eye movement or if it's the Good Eye movement. So the Good Eye will eventually devour the Evil Eye as true Christianity is scribed at a scholarly level, master level, doctorate of divinity level. Yes, a very, very high level of scholarship, which is incredibly important because no movement ever in the history of the world of any nation has ever been accepted until it was scholared and scribed. Amen. So now it's time to scholarly scribe this movement. Red Letter Ministries, RLM TV, RLM Publishing Company, all these things are in the works. This is what you're partnering with this ministry. And I'm not taking up an offering, but it's important. Our partners realize that this is a reformation. You are partnered with the chief apostles of Lamb, two of them right here, Rebekah and I, in a reformation greater than Martin Luther. And that is the truth anyhow. And that's not to incur the evil eye through jealousy. It's true because the evil eye doesn't work on me if you haven't noticed. Because I walk in Joseph. Suffering, the great suffering of Joseph and the suffering of the cross doesn't allow any kindling curse of the evil eye in spirit, soul, mind, flesh, finances, health. They could never get me sick. They could never rob me for more than a day. I get seven times more the next day. They try to do harm to me, and all of a sudden, seven times more comes in. Why is that? It's the sovereign Joseph on my life, predestined, foreordained Joseph. And Joseph is the destruction, the annihilation of the evil eye, and he carries the good eye of the Father. I'm a carrier of the good eye in my generation so that the evil eye will be consumed in all nations for you and your house to be saved from Balaam and the Kelopot and the evil eye. And understand, there's no competition, envy, and strife. It's for salvation. It's leadership. It's rank. It requires honor. It requires rejoicing and dancing and festivities, and we should be writing songs about these things. And guess what? There will be songs written about these things. But right now, we're really in the time of all these things, but Gad the warrior. Gad and his flag was just a war camp. Okay? Gad and the war camp, let's teach on this just for a second now, which means this thing was so brand new. There were so many enemies in the wilderness. You had Balaam trying to kill him. You had the Amalekites, the Perizzites, the Jebusites, and everything else out there trying to kill Israel. And so we needed just war. And so we have the Yare Vave Seve Yad of angel armies, the warrior nature of Prince Michael, who throws Satan down, red dragon beasts and false prophet thrown down, all the fallen angel nations of the Tower of Babel thrown down. And so right now, it's total war. So we're flying the flag, all these 12 flags right now in RLM TV, if you haven't noticed. Reuben the first, Simeon the aggressor, and Simeon, the aggressor's flag was Shechem. His flag was Shechem, where Dinah, the patriarch's sister, was brutally raped. Now, why is that important? Because Simeon flew the flag of Shechem to say, our entire job's duty is to protect the female Israelites. Let that sink in. Oh, the circumcised women protected. There's a whole flag of the 12 tribes of Israel dedicated to it in the Bible. Amen. Take note of that. Levi the priest, Judah the leader. We're going to get into Levi tomorrow, the Urim and the Thummim. I've been studying. I got 25 pages of notes. It's going to be awesome. Judah the leader, Dan the judge, Naphtali the free spirit. A lot of people have a counterfeit free spirit. So the devil, the Kelopot, the evil eye counterfeits the original design of these 12 tribes, which is the protocol of holiness, the protocol of the circumcised of Israel, the protocol of our born again being and state and move and how we live and how we think and how we act and how we practice the good eye towards each other. If we practice the evil eye, we're outside the camp automatically by our thought life. You're not an Israelite. An Israelite is only circumcised of heart with a good eye. The Father Abraham's eye, Father God's eye, Jesus' eye, the eye of the patriarchs, the whole Sephirot, and all of those eyes of the spheres of connection of the Kabbalah circles of Enoch, if those are not emanating Shekinah, the light of life, and the Torah scrolls of life of the heavenly Jerusalem, Bina above, coming down, then there's a disconnect, and we're in the other side, and we're in the Kelopot, and we're in Balaam's camp, and we're practicing evil eye Edomite Christianity. God is now saying to everyone, repent and come into Israel, but you must be circumcised as adults. You can't come under these 12 flags and their benefits unless you take the knife. Oh, it's going to hurt. It's only going to hurt your demons. Mm-hmm. It's only going to hurt your bloodline curses. It's only going to hurt your wicked pride and all your sins and death and things hanging on you, your secret sin, your lust for money, your pornography, and everything else you're doing and behind and putting idols up and saying, I'm good, I'm perfect, I'm this, that, and the other thing. Listen, man. No, we don't listen to any of that. There's no human excuse before God. The sword of the Spirit, the Word of God, cut it all out. Your humanity is sin. My humanity is sin. It's a red worm. Now I'm developing divinity as an impartation through the Word of God. It's called Christianity. Amen? That's what Christianity is. I'm no longer limited to my humanity, but I'm developing divinity as long as I daily take that knife of the sword of the Spirit, the sword the Spirit wields, and the swords the angels wield as a friend. You're cut as a friend instead of as an enemy. Outside these 12 flags, you're cut as an enemy because you're of the evil eye, you're of the Balaam, the wicked Balaam, you're of the Kelopot. You're sorcerers, you're witches, you're dogs, you love lies, you're sexually immoral, you're not in the camp at all, you're not an Israelite, you're a pagan nation, you're a heathen nation. Once you start to get circumcised, you come into Christianity. This is real Christianity. This is first century apostolic Christianity, okay? And now we begin to live within the protocol of the holiness of the angels of the God I am, whom I serve. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So that circumcision and allowing the human, the little red worm, to be cut back. The little yellow worm, the little black worm, the little white worm, the human being, the nations, the 70 nations, dash them to pieces like pottery, Messiah says, red letters. And now we get to develop the divine part of us if we're willing to allow the wicked part of us to fall off, the Kelopot part of us to fall off. You're dashing Kelopots. Dashing Kelopots to pieces like pottery, Ministries Worldwide International Inc.
Like 70 nations of fallen angels.
Amen.
Angel princes of the heathen nations, which are
principalities. Yeah.
Well, what makes us of the tribe of Joseph? Now, this is really interesting. On your cosmic journey, you will go through the tribes like gates. That's why there are certain gates that are open. there's a much deeper study we can do. That's for another time. But understanding, God wants to have his attributes formed in us. And the only way for that to be a permanent habitation of God, right? Not just a visitation. We like that saying, not just a visitation, we want a habitation.
Yeah, I love that song.
It's a good song.
I'm gonna sing it right after this.
Yeah.
And dance like a gazelle too.
Yeah. Mm. And then maybe for just like our exclusive content for partners, that'll be your gift package. Yeah. It'll be that and that. So you should sign up and you can check out the links.
Yeah, the depth of RLM TV is to the very throne of God the Father.
Amen.
So don't just stay on the outskirts. Go deeper. God's calling you deeper. Yeah. Amen.
So to have the habitation instead of a visitation. So, you know, God's desire is he wants to dwell with the fullness of his presence on the physical earth, visibly. Just like when you go to heaven and everyone can visibly see the Father, all his lightning that comes out of him during the worship, all the light show and everything, the glory that makes people fall over, the brightness, all the just the wonder and the awe and the joy of heaven and all the wonderful things that come with that. He wants that on the earth. Wow, doesn't that sound great? So here's the thing. We've got to get with his plan. His plan only includes his nature and characteristics being on the earth, which means inside your earthen vessel. A lot of fire blazing out of my head talking about his. It's his desire. That's why my head lights up with fire when I talk about his desire. My head lights up with fire when I talk about his desire. What is his desire? That's really fascinating. Study the Bible to find out what God wants. And then you take action to do and facilitate what God wants, which is just simply obeying the voice of the Holy Ghost. So when you go into this cosmic ascension, which you're going to get the circumcisions, you're going to take the school of the Magi until you're cosmic, and you're going to take the master class until you're ascending rungs and weeks and understanding exactly what you need to do, you know, in order to do that, it's already mapped out. And it works. The thing is, the flesh usually wants an additional thing. Yeah, you already made the masterclass working 40 hours a week for so many months, doing 2 live shows a day for that time. But I want something in addition to that.
Like, yeah.
I want some witchcraft.
The sign of an Edomite is a time waster. Exactly. What is scribed stays scribed. That class is an eternal class for anyone who goes cosmic, and it will never change.
That's where you'll get your daily rebuke, is the class. So a lot of people are like, rebuke? I want rebuke. Mm. Well, understand this. There was a season for first fruits of a lot of personal rebuke on those that God had selected to have the angels bring them a little bit closer to see if they could receive a personal rebuke. He doesn't do this very often with this ministry, but he had some first fruits. And what that wave was to see how people would respond. So if the response was offense, anger, envy, strife, jealousy, red camp activity, or, you know, offense at rebuke, or even worse, responding with witchcraft, prayer, or sorcery in response to rebukes, whether it was personal or on the live stream, that determined a lot of things, you know, eternal things.
I got a rebuke right now, especially for all the men watching. Listen to me now, because that's, you're in great danger. When you try to correct or humble someone operating in a good eye in a higher rung, and you're in a lower rung, you're in the evil eye. You've just been clipped into the kelipot. Repent.
And usually that wrong reaction to God's word coming down sapphire stones manifests itself in the form of being offended at the word of God and responding with a revelation that you believe you already have. No, this is a revelation I have that I know, instead of receiving the higher word coming down sapphire stones that will offend and prick what we think we already know. And that's just part of the process. So basically what God has established is first fruits who responded well to the first wave of teaching of righteousness, whether it was the live stream, you know, teaching and correction. Here's the thing. We're all students here of God, his universe that he created, his ways. And so if you're a good student in anything, you have at least enough wisdom to receive correction. Let's say this is a woodworking shop, and the teacher gives us each a block of wood. It's the same block of wood that everybody starts with. Maybe some basswood, because it's easy to carve basswood, right? Here it is, and here's the beginner set of tools to chisel and carve out the pattern. And I want you to carve out the pattern that was shown to Moses on the mountain. We're all gonna carve out a nice pattern today, class. Amen. Here's your safety rules. Here's your beginner's level chisel. It's not super sharp, but the wood is really easy. This is our beginner level entry wood. First, you're gonna take your pattern and we're gonna transcribe that, transpose, you transfer. We're gonna use transfer paper. And then you're gonna take your pen, your pencil, your iPad, you know, and trace and become familiar. First, we're gonna draw the pattern. Oh, very nice, very nice. And now we're gonna put it on the block of wood. Okay, you've been practicing making the pattern, put it on the wood, and now you've got it transposed onto the wood. And now we take the potentially dangerous part, sharp object. Don't chisel away the whole wood block. Just make the pattern inscribed. Just what Moses was shown on the mountain. Just what Jesus described in the Lord's Prayer, the lightning path, right? That's the pattern of the temple. The pattern that John saw, John the Revelator in the book of Revelation, the same pattern in the whole Bible, what the temple is, the tabernacle, you know. What's the end goal here? A habitation.
Yeah.
That's the goal. So we need to get our little carving tools out. And classroom basic rules. Nobody, you know, especially the young boys or the agitated little girls, no stabbing each other with the chisels. You're just only your block of wood, your little section. Make sure you're this far apart from each other when you're using it. Don't flail around with it.
Yeah, the priesthood tools, learning how to use them as young buckwheat Christians, fresh born again. Most of the things they get from God, they begin to attack each other with.
That's why kids get safety scissors in kindergarten.
That's right. And so Christians need safety scissors and they need safety knives. We go with the tools of the priests when they're born again, because everything they get from God, whether it be teaching, preaching, revelation, wisdom, training, discipleship, you'll find they always abuse it at first. Yeah. I've never seen any exception, because there's always the foreskin and membrane by the activation of the thing that came from God. Now, through making mistakes, there's a repentance, a circumcision. It doesn't mean you make mistakes, but you will. And they'll be uncovered every level of growth. And you will be embarrassed. You will be humiliated. You will suffer, not because of God, because of what you are. And the realization of that in the consciousness is our true humility.
Amen. I remember in one of my art classes, just even in high school, I think it was like a sophomore year class. It was a great art class. Super fun. I loved art classes, and those fun times of the day you get to draw and paint, color, all these fun things, make sculptures.
I remember the first time I saw your art. I'm like, that's so cute. You kept your childhood artwork from when you were a little kid. She's like, I drew that last month.
It was like a few months ago. Just having fun with watercolors. Prophetic art.
I was like, man, Lord, forgive the evil eye. Forgive the evil eye.
You know what's funny is those same pictures that we were laughing about with the watercolors, I had sat down in 2019, just before for 2020, and I had been gazing into the glory, because I'd started to see the water fountain everywhere, and it looked like it was raining continually all around me, like a cloud full of rain, and I would gaze into it, and then I would see visions, and I would take the watercolors, and I would paint these. It looks like a little kid did these, but I had fun. I would read the Bible out loud to Jesus in my house, and just have fun with that and worship
him. It was anointed.
And I would gaze into the glory, and I would make these paintings. And when I would paint it, those exact ones that I'd showed him that I was like so proud of my looks was actually a map to the ladder, Jacob's ladder, in how to get there. It was an actual realm. I was like, I called it the sunset realm. And I didn't understand, but it looked like a big flower, but it was the sun. It was the ladder going up into the sun, which is the staff of Moses. And so I was like, it looks like a staff, but it looks like a vine, right? Jesus says, I am the vine. You are the branches. You can graft
out of the hands, mouths, and senses and temples of children comes perfect praise or perfect prophetics. That's because they don't have an evil eye.
Amen. So I was just having fun painting, gazing into the glory. And I couldn't tell in this realm. I called it the sunset realm because it more closely resembled sunset, but it looked like it could have been a sunrise too. I found out later on it's about the sunrise and sunset of the divine chariot of revelation, which is the chariot of the sun. And the Ophanim that pulls the sun actually has a higher rank than the prince of all the Ophanim because it's such an honor.
Wow.
Isn't that wild?
That's wild.
Just gazing into the water stream and painting, la 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 la, you know. And, man, and then I also painted, I think there was one
really
I painted.
Really shows how foolish I was in judging it at first. Isn't it?
Great mitzvah meriting rewards for humility.
Judaic artifact of the 19th heaven. You foolish Edomite.
And one of them, I drew a picture of the kelapot, and I didn't know. It looked like a black fireworks with the red Edomite camp.
Amen.
And so I knew it was, I was painting what was on the other side. So here I had a picture of the kelapot on one page, and another page was this beautiful green meadow, and it had the staff of righteousness, the path that leads up into the sun. And there was another one, it had the roses, but the roses were the rose was crying because no one would go up. And it was just like, oh man, it's just so real.
Yeah.
And I just, by simple faith, when we do these things, when you have fun in the Holy Ghost, I would encourage you, if you don't know how to go cosmic yet, we have School of the Magi, but if you're just coming out of like whatever version of Christianity exists out there, or Judaism or New Age or whatever, you're going to want to find and realize the glory within you. If you're a child of God. And that was something I took very seriously, what Brandon was teaching, which is to lay hands on your spirit.
Inner intelligence.
And put the word of God into your eyes. Lay hands on your spirit. Build up your spirit.
Yeah, there's no escaping the red worm flesh or whatever nation you're of. It don't matter. it really doesn't matter at all, except you become God inside-minded.
Yeah.
Unless you have an inner intelligence, a kindling mm-hmm. of your spirit, there's yeah. no potential in God, because God is spirit. Mm-hmm. Those who worship and return to God must be in spirit mm-hmm. and in truth. John 4:24.
And even those mystics of long ago who would teach on the interior castles or God inside-mindedness, like Jian Guyan, Teresa of Avila, who she would have, you know, she would be levitating and being raptured, and God showed her the interior castles. They all teach about the interior. And I can't remember, it's one of those two ladies that had talked about, who knew the Lord really well, had talked about you first have to seek him on the inside. That way you have all the powers of the soul to seek him in the heavens. Yeah. And that's true. And so God inside-mindedness is the first step. Amen. Here's the thing, is your whole life that you've lived, if it's mostly just your flesh, right? Like before you came to earth, the eternal part of you, it's that little gingerbread man and woman of light, what male or female, whoever God created you, in the guff, inside of the Father, when he populated the guff full of souls before sending us to earth. When Lucifer used to step into the guff to lead the worship, to he was supposed to reflect the glory and give it to the Lord, give it to God, and he started taking the glory to himself. And it was subtle, but it was wicked. So where you're in the guff inside the Father during that time, that's why some people, they think they have memories from their past life.
There's no reincarnation.
Like yeah.
But there is a connection to the living in heaven. Mm-hmm. It's totally different.
So that's just, I knew you before I knit you together in your mother's womb. That's where you came from, the Father's guff. And he knits you together to that piece of flesh during conception. So when your whole life that you've lived, even if it's about spirituality, if it's not the regeneration of your spirit, your eternal inner man, like your ruah of your little gingerbread man of light, when you receive Jesus, and especially when you get baptized in the Holy Spirit and born again, that is what resurrects and comes to life. It's literally like Lazarus being raised from the dead, and then you learn how to take the grave clothes off, which is the flesh life, the carnal life. Because until you have that resurrection moment of being born again and you're baptized in the Holy Spirit and you have that evidence of speaking in tongues that comes, your little inner man, gingerbread man of light, gingerbread woman of light, is dormant, yeah. dead like a seed. You have to realize the glory. You have to be filled with the Holy Spirit.
You gotta feed your spirit. The gospel is to awaken hearts. You know, the little red worm, just to touch on this, because this is where everyone's at. There's so much carnality, it's out of control. Let's trim it back through wisdom, revelation, and insights into Torah. The reason why we call it small red worm is because Adam was called small red worm in Torah after he fell. It's not you individually, it's not you personally, the white worm, the red worm, the yellow worm, the black worm, it's you're all Adam. And Adam, by Yarevavhe, because of the accuracy of Torah, is called small red worm. That's what Adam means in Hebrew, okay? So that Adamic nature, that carnal nature, that fleshly nature is that red nature. It's not a big red dragon nature. No, that's the Kelopot. You're limited to your flesh in that natural dimension. Now, as citizens of the New Jerusalem through being born again, that small, tiny, little red worm, that Adamic part of you, can actually transition and submit the inner intelligence to Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit, the holy angels, the gospel, the Torah scrolls, and begin to develop and go back up into the dimension we gave to the Kelopot, which is the fallen angels. But it takes a realization of the small red worm, which is your flesh and blood. All your blood's red. So why do we look on the skins? That's deception. That's the magic spell. That's Balaam. Balaam divides and conquers, but we're united under the 12 flags of Israel, the Israel of God, Galatians 6. Well, there are Greeks, there's Latins, there's Jews in that church. There's all the nations in the Galatians church. If you read the Bible and study church history, it wasn't just one kind of people. Literally everyone would go into these things, and the demons didn't know what to do. They'd never seen anything like it. It took them hundreds of years to figure out a plan to shut it down, and they finally did by taking the Kabbalah, the New Covenant, and turn it into a Greek and Latin religion. Understand, it was all so you don't discover the inner man's potential and ability when you're connected to the patriarchs. But if you limit yourself to the small red worm, that little red part of you, which is your blood, your little worm in the dirt, little worm in the dust, you forfeit your birthright in Christ and the potential of rising on Jesus Christ's ladder and Jacob's ladder and becoming who God created you to be. That's why God requires repentance. The circumcision of heart is getting the kelipot out, the evil eye out, and saying yes to what you don't deserve that the patriarchs have in each rung from glory to glory. Amen.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. We go into the.
You want to do teaching? Any? Do you want to do any of that today?
It's we got 10 minutes. Okay. Let's go into it. Let's start.
Okay.
And tomorrow we'll talk about the flag of Levi.
Yeah, we might do some more of this stuff tomorrow too. Isn't that nice? Well, that's where you want to go. And we certainly don't want to go into the kelipot. Because that is the path of destruction.
We want to really make it easy for you, not confusing or complicated. Kelipot is any time you're tempted or practicing the evil eye of strife, self-absorption, entitlement, that I deserve something, the pride, the lust, the greed, or the ill will towards others, or the jealousy of others' blessings that they've merited through circumcisions. That's all evidence that you are now going into the kelipot, the evil eye. So we make it real simple for you. Evil eye and good eye. Balaam or Abraham. There's only those two fathers and those two schools in the whole earth, and there's nothing else. Simple as that.
Okay. I guess we can kind of just, you know, we'll touch on some of this stuff here. That's fine. Okay, we have a little diagram here. You can see there's a little heavens up above and some flower, probably a rose that opens the door to the cosmos or the, you know, the multiverse. What does that even mean? Okay, well, what do we have below there? 9 orders of angels. You know, we talk about this stuff, the different signs, but what does this have to do with anything? Well, if you recall this, this has to do with your cosmic ascension and those first, you know, those first primary weeks when you ascend through what? The angelic spheres. This is the same as the other chart that we looked at where it's just the spheres, the planetary powers. This is just another outline, a different way of diagramming it so you can just have a fresh perspective. Sometimes when we get used to seeing things one way, God will change our perspective on it so that we can hear it fresh, so we don't feel like we already know. That sphere of the fixed stars of the zodiac, that represents the 12 tribes. So when you're talking about the 12 zodiac signs and people talk about astrology, blah blah blah, in the oral tradition, the scribes have understood for many years that as Jews, we don't practice astrology. That is considered a very low level, low form of any kind of interpretation. And what it's devolved into in today's society is basically like your pop sugar, cosmopolitan, base your next weekend life decisions on whether you talk to that guy at the bar or not, depending on what your horoscope says, and that's modern society. How far is that fallen from the holy ephod of the 12 tribes set apart for the use and the purposes of God Almighty, YHVH, who has created the heavens and the earth? And what we find is that his way is actually better than the earthly way. Never be upset when you see the wicked who have the wealth and the money. God is just. He's fair. He's righteous in everything that he does. He's simply waiting for his people to walk into maturity of righteousness before things begin to be transferred. That's the kingdom of heaven come is what? The kingdom of heaven is at hand is what? Simply stepping into maturity and cosmic righteousness. One of the aspects of the teaching of the principalities of Molech, the fallen angels, all the other ones whose names, I don't even feel like bothering to mention their names today. Because eventually their names will never be mentioned again, which is exciting. And so they're going to be gone into the sea of forgetfulness, and then we'll never, the only memory of that will be that museum in the future of how well the sons of God killed and conquered them.
Yep.
And it's just basically like carcass trophies, like the carcass of Leviathan is one of the promised trophies.
Welcome to Cave of Treasures, the new earth.
Amen. So, yeah, nice Leviathan carcass for a cute tent for our dinner party, which should be fantastic. I think that'll be wonderful. So let's take a look here. We want to walk in a greater maturity. And one of the teachings of the enemy side, they always try to influence the hearts and the minds of the sons of God into thinking that to walk into maturity, we just need to do anything else but circumcision and upward ascension. And I've also been a victim of that. And by victim, I mean because of the shortcomings and the faults in my own soul. From my own past experiences, there have been times in dealing with confrontations of the enemy side that I would almost believe what they were saying because of magic spells of the enemy. And what I'm finding, the higher that I go in circumcision, it's not about anything else but simple circumcision and rising. It's not about anything below or, you know, going side to side. It's always a temptation every single time, every world,
like
every
sandworm activity really counts for nothing, like Jesus Christ said in John 6. Yes. All that matters is building on the solid rock of sapphire stones.
So this 12 tribes here, it's represented in the 12, those 12 main zodiac signs. But what that is, it's about living under the stars, which means you're limited to a few attributes of each. Now understand, there is a 12 below, there is also a 12 above. And what does that mean? Well, because the people of God are not walking in maturity, God wanted to make sure there was an allowance of his beneficence, his goodness, to be available in the earth, even though his people were not walking in righteousness. And without the common grace that would just rain on the righteous and the wicked, a lot of people would just die because there was simply not grace to even live. So what does that mean? The end of the time and the common era, the era of common grace. It means progressively more and more you must walk in righteousness in order to be allowed to live on the earth. And that's the pressure, the great tribulation that comes upon the earth in progressive measurements is, are you walking in righteousness, yes or no? Because without so much pressure, nobody would ever do it. We'd be waiting another, you know, so many thousand years. And that's not in his plan. The plan is get to neshama, get cosmic, circumcise your soul, circumcise your heart. So that's the plan. But so when we're living under the stars, so those 12 zodiac signs, everybody who comes to earth, right, that little gingerbread man or gingerbread woman of light, God has you brought to the earth, you're carried by an angel, and he knits you together in your mother's womb. On your way down, there are stars in a certain arrangement. And it's said in the oral tradition that even every blade of grass has a star and an angel assigned over it. There's that many stars in existence. So if that's a blade of grass, how much more do you have stars and angels set over you? You're more important than a blade of grass. Hallelujah. So living under the stars, what that means is you're limited to a few attributes of each, depending on your bloodline, which means which of the 12 tribes did you come from, or which tribe of Gentiles did you come from? But ultimately, we all come from Adam and Eve.
That's right.
So what bloodline did you come from? And what star seed or what stars and houses were you born under? Which means what principalities of heathen nations or the Jewish nation, what stars did you come down through? Where were the alignments? And what that does is that is kind of the Rubik's Cube or the random, you know, if you go to a randomizer online with an algorithm and you hit the random button, it rolls the dice. This is, in a way, it feels like a dice roll, but really it's the wisdom of God to give each soul the maximum opportunity to know him. But it feels random to people, time and chance that happened to us all. Ecclesiastes, what is that? That's living under the stars. Whereas in the oral tradition of Moses, the Jewish wise men and sages understood that as Jews, we are meant to walk above the stars.
Amen.
Which means that all the time and chance and astrology, they don't take it seriously because they understand that God, Yod-Heh, Vav-Heh,
that's the real Issachar anointing,
is above the stars.
Above the stars, scholarship of sapphire stones. It was the gemstone of the ephod of Issachar was a sapphire stone, and their flag was literally the cosmos. So a whole entire house of Israel was dedicated for scholarship of the abilities of Yod-Heh Vav-Heh for Israel in the stars, in the sun, in the moon, in the cosmos. And that is a huge aspect of a true Christian's life today. Mm-hmm. And we don't even understand that that's Torah wisdom, guys. That's Torah wisdom, and we need to be reattached to it because a lot of that's been stolen from us by the fallen angels. And so we need to repent and become complete Jews, circumcised of heart, complete Christians, mm-hmm. with all these 12 flags flying over our heads. Amen.
Amen. So this represents the ephod, also represents the pattern of the temple. This is the pattern of the tabernacle, the temple, the pattern how male and female he created them, in the image of God he created them. And this is the same, that's that path, as this. It's the same. It's just a different view here of it with the spheres. So what does that mean? It means to live above that line, you would have to ascend these rungs with full circumcision. This here, the only evidence that the scholarship of Torah is effective is the evidence of a tender heart and love toward the Tzaddik. All Torah scholarship that does not tenderize the heart toward the Tzaddik is due to the presence of the scholar demon. It is by divine design that learned scholars are wont to oppose the Tzaddikim. This is from the oral tradition. So learned scholars actually typically, traditionally over the generations, oppose the Tzaddikim in each generation.
That's Levin.
Yeah. And when that which the upper Tzaddik originates, the oral law, is studied by a righteous person in this world, the lower Tzaddik, there is a binding of spirit between them. That's how you attach yourself to the Tzaddik of your generation, by being a true Torah scholar of righteousness with
that's
a tender
making
heart.
A covenant in the Holy Ghost.
Mm-hmm. Yep, with a good eye.
That's why it's called a covenant.
However, when someone who lacks decency and respect studies the upper Tzaddik's teachings, he causes the oral law or the divine presence to descend into exile. This teaching then becomes a weapon in the mouth of the scholar demon with which he persecutes the lower Tzaddik. This is possible because of the nature of the Torah is twofold, life-giving in the hands of the lower Tzaddik, but poisonous in the hands of the scholar demon. Thus, despite the Tzaddik's personal level of righteousness, which he certainly invests into his teaching, an unworthy person can take improper guidance from that teaching of oral law. This is because, in order to bring livelihood to the world, the Tzaddik includes the quality of the left side, which is the aspect of sinners will stumble in them, right? That whole, all those spheres we saw, left, right, and middle, that's all the holy tree of life.
It's Jesus.
It's Jesus. And so, in, you know, people say, oh, well, not to the left, not to the right. Well, that means not to the cross on the left, not to the cross on the right, which is black and white witchcraft. And certainly not that sneaky, more subtle than any serpent in the field, which sneaks up behind the other one, which is Balaam.
Yeah, the red magic.
Mm-hmm. So this study of Torah not purely for its own sake, is used by the scholar demon to arrogantly oppose the Zadokim. And so with this, one of your best defense is we bind the Tefillin, which is the word of God, over our Gevra portal of our heart and over our mind, and we don on the Talit of our Father, which is the holy prayer shawl, with that beneficent eye toward all. We judge the people of God righteously. We judge them favorably.
Putting on the good eye
yep.
of the Father. Yep. It's a white garment of revelation.
Amen. And so part of that head covering here has to do with the original letters. We might get into some of that. I think mainly we'll probably cover more of this tomorrow.
Yeah, we got another half hour of teaching here.
We'll cover this tomorrow, but there's one picture in here I wanted to show you guys. Oh, we'll get into emotions. Don't worry.
We'll do Levi and a whole lot of other stuff tomorrow.
Amen. There's just one thing that's important for you to know tonight before Amen. We go. And this tree, you don't have to study this exactly particular, but I want you to just get a good look at the picture. Notice there's that underground kind of thing here going on. Let's take a look here. And it's calling this, you know, the Klippith manifestations, Lilith, Samael.
Listen, buckwheats, it's time to understand the Kelopot so you don't get clipped. This is life and death right here. Pay attention.
So here we'll see on the right-hand side, you'll see our normal ascension, what we talk about every day. And there is the earth sphere, that's Malkut. Now, what is there right below? That is what ends up being that cosmic abyss that we might talk about later on, or maybe tomorrow. But what happens? So you're supposed to ascend with exact circumcisions, which means you circumcise your heart according to the instructions of that sphere. It's those first and second incisions that you make with the fruit being born of it. So you bear the fruit of Malkut. You go through all four levels of Malkut, circumcise them in the name of Jesus Christ. And once that's complete, it comes with the evidence of you bearing the fruit of that rung. So you will have all the good fruit bearing of that rung of Malkut of Isaiah with the evidence of the fruit of your life and that manifestation of peace at that level. And then what happens is that your angels, not somebody else's angels, but your angels will bring signs and wonders. You'll want minimum two to three signs and wonders confirming after you've already borne the fruit of the circumcision. So what does that mean? It means just because you keep seeing Venus on your home feed, or just because you see, you know, somebody post about Netza today, or somebody posted about Hod or the moon. Let's say you saw, well, I keep seeing the moon all over. Usually that's just your angels encouraging you. Hey, you know, beloved friend, you are supposed to go cosmic soon. So study. Because you will usually have many, many signs and wonders about all of the rungs before you're even ready to go cosmic. And I think that can be surprising for some people. But you've got to really tune in and hear the voice of God. Because if you just go up and you just went up circumcisions, and let's say you go to Netza or Hod or like the sun, Tiferet, and you didn't actually finish Malkut with full circumcisions, you didn't actually go then the very next one, you stopped at Yasod, and you got the one and two circumcisions there, and you bore the fruit with exact signs and wonders from your angels after bearing the fruitfulness of it, that there's evidence that you had removal of foreskin and membrane on each rung, and not just like a zipped up and then take care of it later. No, it's Yasod. You had one and two circumcisions each, and each rung came with minimum two to three signs and wonders that were not your GTs, were not your gold dust, diamond dust, gemstone dust, whatever.
And not from watching RLM TV.
Not from watching RLM TV, because we talk about all of them all the time.
We talk about every rung every day, so that
does
not
count. Amen. And it's not your personal visions, because when you're coming out of that red camp, one of the characteristics is lying visions.
And then,
so it cannot be your own visions, your own GTs, your own diamond dust, gold dust. Because even going up the weeks, there's a lot of delusion you have to deal with. So you have to be solid and know. And it helps to really have those people who've gone before you, if you're already ascending, you know, you go through the school of the Magi, so you know what the fruit is. Then when you bear that fruit, you'll recognize it. Amen. And then so you go to Hod and you do the same thing. You should have already been at Hod, and you have two signs and wonders, exact circumcisions, bearing the fruit with 2 to 3, I would say even 3 to 4 manifest signs and wonders when you're early on, because there's so many temptations for young buckwheats to go up higher than they should. Then when you're bearing the fruit of it in perfect peace on Hod, not hurry up, let me go forward, but your angels have given you the approval. You've heard the voice of God like the river of life inside you, confirming to you that it's time to go to Netza. And then you go, and it's not the voice of another God, a false Holy Spirit. But, you know, you got to Netza, and then you have knowledge from studying what that's supposed to look like. And you get the first circumcision of that foreskin and the circumcision of the membrane. And then it's complete. You've already heard the voice of God on the inside of you guiding you. You've listened to that masterclass part about Netza. You've heard that. And then you have perfect peace, that manifest peace of God. It's not just visions or gold dust or nothing like that. It's just your angels giving you the confirmations after you already know that you know that you know. And the Spirit of God, the river of life inside of you, has already told you you're bearing the fruit of it. This is the fruit. And you know there's a change in you. There's a specific change in the way you act, think, feel, and believe at each rung. And it's very, very clear. It's not messy. It's not confusing. It's not a mystery. It does not remain mysterious. It's exact. And if you didn't have each and every one of those before you went up, we've had several people that have gotten up into the black sun only just to go back down and realize that they were in the clippeth the entire time. So please don't be one of those people, because the only possible thing for you to be doing, if you're in uncircumcision and you go beyond, it's not going to be peaceful. You're going to feel like you're on edge all the time, like it's an emergency 24/7, 365. And or it's just a lot of pride, a lot of arrogance, a lot of witchcraft stuff, until we humble ourselves back to the rung we're supposed to be on. So you've got to do it right. Remember the tortoise and the hare. How did the turtle win the race? Slow and steady, but thorough. That's actually the fastest way to do it, is do it correctly the first time. We've already had several people who got into like black Netza and the black sun, or worse and higher than that, and then they have to go back to their rung, where they're actually, where's the last place you know that you actually had the full circumcision? Because if you haven't actually completely overcome Jezebel's tower, guess what? You shouldn't even be cosmic at all. You should be on Malkut. And a lot of people think, well, in my mind, I don't think I have lust. I don't think I have that pride. But you've never overcome those circumcisions. You've never really gotten that nature out of you. It's not about a mental agreement. That's a mental ascension. When the nature of that sin is removed from your heart, that's how you know you're bearing the fruit. And why is that important? Because all of those clippeth ones on the left-hand side, those represent the uncircumcisions. What these are is, if you, for example, if you know about the quantum entanglement of electrons or particles, if we measure one particle and it's spinning one way, we know automatically that the other one is spinning the other way. What does that mean in terms of the clippeth? What does that tell us about the invisible realm? Whenever you get into the uncircumcision, so let's take a look here on the left-hand side. If you see those spheres, if you got up into the black sun, look on the left-hand side at the black sun diagram. There's an arrow. If you can carefully follow, there's a lot of arrows there. Look at how far down that is. Do you see how many rungs? That's 1, 2, 3. Let's see. One, two, three. That's four rungs lower than Malkut. So, if, for those of you, you know, you got into the Black Sun and you repented back to Malkut, or you repented back to wherever you repented back to. When you, let's say, if you repented from Black Sun to Hod of Righteousness, that means when you were in the Black Sun, you were actually way below every believer that's on Malkut, far below them in the abyss. That abyss below Malkut is endless. Just as the throne of God, the Holy Sephirot, Jacob's ladder, goes up worlds without end, the abyss of Satan's Klippoth goes for eternities of descending into hell.
Truth. Bottomless pit.
It's a bottomless pit, which means, guess what? The higher up you go, and then you get into one of these black, these Klippoth here. Like, look at Black Cutter. Let's say you're like, I'm just going to keep going up. I know I'm ready. I can do it. I just feel like God's calling me, blah, blah, blah. You don't even have one in circumcision. And then you get up to Keter. Look how far you have to climb out of the abyss just to get to base camp and Malkut. And some people who've come into RLM were like that. They were like, hey, there was one gentleman and his girlfriend. And then they had messaged us after watching this show. And they said, we just realized we were in the Klippoth. We'd been ascending. Oh my goodness. Like, thank God someone was here to tell us the truth. They went back down to Malkut, got into the right camp, and the peace came back. Wow. So never feel like, oh, I'm missing out. Oh, I don't want to go all the way back down. What do you mean? You can't get any lower. I mean, you can get lower. But if you get into Black Sun, you're lower than everybody on Malkut. So if you're in Malkut in the Cave of Treasures, feel good, because most believers out there who are getting into cosmic ascension that doesn't have circumcision, or they do it the wrong way, they do it with the evil eye, they're way below your level. You're at one of the highest levels in all of the world. Because anyone who goes up in the Klippoth is way below you. That's why when people start to get ambitious, they get itchy to go to the next rung, because, like, I don't want anyone to surpass me, you know, or I don't want to be held back. I don't want to be held back. And then they get into the clip, and they get clipped, and they start clipping while they're clipping. They're clipping while they're tripping all the way down into the bottomless pit. And now you're not even at baseline salvation. You're a servant of Satan's throne. That's why we get serious
the
about
the small
this.
Little hints that this is happening in your life is those subtle disagreements with the Zadik, the subtle corrections of the Zadik's wisdom that's coming from the path of lightnings.
Yeah.
As it's written, Genesis 3:1, the serpent was more subtle than all the beasts of the field. So it's those subtleties where you begin to see that they are contradicting the pure wisdom that comes down from the Sephirot. That's a person clipped.
Amen. So it's just, you know, get some wisdom here. Never be over ambitious to go forward, because unless you get a full circumcision at that rung, like if you already went to Netzah or you already went to the Sun, but you don't have the verified Malkut full circumcision with confirming signs and wonders, full circumcision Yasod, confirming signs and wonders for each and every one, Hod and Netzah and then the Sun. If you don't have that, just in case anybody out there is like floating around in the Black Sun, because we don't want that for you. The only, if you don't get fully circumcised, your only next progression is only possible to be Klippoth only. There are no exceptions to this. God does not change his way for anybody. It's just the,
amen.
It's just the harsh reality.
It's Torah law.
Of how things work. But you got to understand that. And why, what's this line on the right hand side? Every time you get to Hesed, when you go to Bina next, you jump over Da'at. You never go to Da'at as a rung, because in the current state of the fall, that desire for extraneous knowledge is only the service of the bone throne of Satan. So if you're like, oh, well, I'm just going to go to Da'at, and it's you're just going from Jupiter, guess what? You're immediately
all the way down.
Yeah.
It's putting the fruit back on the tree every time you jumped at.
Yep.
Truth and hell.
Yep. So there's that. And then what's his trash can? And here's just a different way you could see the pictures, how it goes down. It's like a mirror image at the bottom. It looks like you're ascending. And because of that quantum entanglement, it looks like people who are in Sorcerer Heights, like in the false, like the black absolute
they
uncircumcision.
They get blinder. They really
they
get
look
blinder.
Like
you notice
they're
that? And they
next to you.
Well, they get blinder, and then, but people around them can see the evil eye. That's what I wanted to just, for you guys that are being subtly tempted by that, because all of you are, because you're being taught righteousness, it's the subtleties of the evil eye. The evil eye exposure is how you guard yourself from these temptations.
Right.
So once you understand how the evil eye works, the evil eye will grow in you as you get clipped. And so all of a sudden you'll find yourself being more emotional, more at strife, more in disagreement towards the Zadik, more dishonorable. You don't want to tithe anymore. And so all the fruits of the evil one become more and more apparent as you go deeper in the Kelopot. Yep.
And so understand that cosmic trash can is there because God's cleaning up the trash in this day and age. He really is.
Amen.
So with the moon being the plumb line, that's actually in our masterclass. It's in the scriptures, actually, that Yesod is the plumb line. That's a really fascinating topic for study. I would highly suggest that you go through the masterclass, go through the School of the Magi. But that plumb line is what? Standing on the moon, clothed in the sun. And so you really want to be in the cave of treasures because the true earthen vessel of holiness is going to be on the moon. You're going to be standing on the moon. Right now is the time to learn and grow and circumcise. I would be just be thorough. If you are making progress toward your circumcision, God notices that. He sees that. If you're just casually being a goofy goober and you're a joker and you're just goofing around, I can just take it easy. I already learned so much from the glory stream. Look, listen.
Yep.
All of that is going in the cosmic trash.
Little Red Worm Ministries.
And what Malkut is that, you might ask? Well, the old earth will be done away with. So the Cave of Treasures, when you go into that world, that's the only part that's being transported upward. That's the only part. So just really focus on getting Malkut circumcised completely. Be accurate, be thorough, and get to know the voice of God. In those days, it's written, no one's going to say no God, because everyone's going to know him. And eventually, there's not going to be a Klippeth. It's just going to be these and the boundary stones. These are the boundary stones of the 12 tribes, the camp. Everything outside is trash. And worlds without end. We'll get into some of that, but amen.
And that is the total obliteration of the evil eye. So the new heavens and new earth is the new heavens and new earth where there's no Balaam sorcery, Laban scholar demon. That it's simply evil eye versus good eye, guys. And so it's a very simple discernment, but we don't want it just judging others. We need it judged in ourselves. We're going to end with this. I want you guys to understand the grace and the value and the importance of RLM TV. It's important you understand the grace that's in this ministry, this apostleship, what it is, television, media, scholarship, it's everything. It's the whole kingdom of Israel. It really is. And understand that Zebulun, whose flag is the ship, is the business person, and the function of the tribe of Zebulun is to provide finances for the scholarship of the tribe of Issachar to study the sun and the moon on Issachar's flag and to scribe them on sapphire stones. That is Torah. That's Zebulun and Issachar, Torah, wisdom, level 101. So all of you in the marketplace, understand, if you want to grow in the marketplace, don't withhold. Build the houses of scholarship of Israel. Build the houses of publication and RLM TV. Understand this. The level of academics right now that's coming through Rebekah and I and RLM TV is better than 95% of the universities of Christianity in the United States of America. They start at $16,000 for a full load of credits. They go up to $65,000 for a full load of credits in every Christian university in the United States of America. I know, because I spent 5 years in an accredited university, 15 different scholars writing translations of the Bible. And you need to understand that this content and material is of higher quality than those classrooms already today while we're in Miami doing missions and not even in our main studio. Understand that, because it's true. So let the grace and importance of what we're doing here, this great mitzvah to establish Israel, to establish New Covenant Christian Judaism and kosher Kabbalah in the context of the fulfillment of Messiah and Torah law, be established here in houses of scholarship by businessmen waving that flag of a ship and beginning to really support Red Letter Ministries, RLM TV, in a major way, like you would for an alma mater of a university. You're proud to be a part of that house. You know, and a tithe is meager in proportion to a tuition. Think about that. Think about the tithe as the minimum and the tuition as the goal, that I could give a tuition level support to the house of Zebulun, to the house of Issachar, to the house of Judah, to the house of Dan, to the 12 tribes, and to Levi in the center, protecting the ark and its container and guarding the very throne of God with angel armies, because that's the reality of RLM TV. Be a part of that reality. Become partners today. Start supporting. Start with the tithe. That's the minimum. Melchizedek of the book of Hebrews, which is the Leviticus of the New Testament, says you are in the order of Melchizedek. Melchizedek received the tithe from Abraham. That cave of treasures of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, if you are going towards it, must begin with the tithe and see the goal for your houses, for your marketplace, for your ships, for your Zebulun anointing, the tuition, $16,000 a year, $65,000 a year, and there's no cap. How high do you want to go? As long as you're supporting the Father's vision of the 12 tribes of Israel, cosmic Israel, heavenly Jerusalem, the apostles of the Lamb, and the building on sapphire stones, there's no cap except what you put on it by your unbelief. Sign up today, rlm.tv. We'll see you guys tomorrow. Amen. Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, esteemed guests and beloved supporters, today I stand before you with a heart filled with gratitude and a vision illuminated by faith. We are gathered here not just as individuals, but as a collective force with a shared purpose, to extend a hand of abundance, to bring forth prosperity, and to manifest the heavenly realities in our world. As we embark on this journey together, I am reminded of the words of Proverbs 3, 9, and 10, which says, "Honor the Lord with your wealth, with the first fruits of all your crops. Then your barns will be filled to overflowing, and your vats will brim over with new wine." It is through our acts of honoring and abundance that we have the opportunity to make a tangible difference in the lives of those around us. RLM TV's missions are not confined by geographical boundaries. From the bustling streets of Florida to the sprawling landscapes of America, from the vibrant city of Nairobi, Kenya, to the farthest reaches of the globe, our mission knows no limits. We are driven by a commitment to serve, a commitment rooted in the teachings of Matthew 6:33, where it is proclaimed, "Seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well." With your support, we have the power to manifest abundance, to uplift communities, to sow seeds of prosperity that will yield a harvest of blessings for generations to come. Your generosity is not merely a financial transaction. It is an investment in the heavenly realities, an investment in the betterment of our world. In the book of Malachi 3:10, we are reminded that "bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that there will be not enough room to store it." Let us therefore open the floodgates of heaven with our giving. with the overflow of our hearts, and with the promise of a more than enough abundance. Today, I humbly ask you to join us on this noble journey. Your contributions will enable us to continue this vital work, to reach even further, to serve more, and to manifest the heavenly realities around the world. As you open your hearts and your hands in generosity, may you be blessed abundantly, not just in material wealth, but in the riches of glory, in the joy of giving, and in the knowledge that you have co-created in the building of the kingdom of heaven on earth. As our Jewish sages taught, tithing is the holiness available below. And as our Master Jesus the Christ proclaimed, give, and it will be given back to you, good measurements that overflow. Together, let us be the agents of change that our world so desperately needs. Together, let us be the vessels of prosperity that bring forth the heavenly realities. Together, let us make miracles happen. Thank you from the depths of my heart for your unwavering support and your boundless generosity. May the fruitful abundance of heaven overflow in your life. God bless you. Amen.